Thank you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
Our salvation is a gift and we've got to wear it. You know, if you're given something as a gift to wear, you need to wear it. You need to wear it. It's no good. None of these things are any use if they just sit on a platform today. None of these things are any use if they just sit in a cupboard. They've got to be put on. They've got to be worn. The helmet's got to be put on. So say to your neighbor again, put it on. And I think that's what we struggle with, because we want to be good. That's our aim in life. We think that if we can be good for God, then he will love us a little bit more. And I've said it so many times, but I'm going to say it again because someone needs to hear it. God can't love you any more than he loves you right now as your bad old self. Because we'll see good in doing good. We'll see the positive in every negative. We'll see the possible in every impossible. We'll see the solution in every problem. So put it on. So I got to confess something. See, that wasn't the place to put a pregnant pause, was it, really? Because now it's got your minds going in all sorts. I love this. Wonder what you think I'm going to say next. As I was studying this, I got frustrated because I felt like I'd missed the point. I felt like I said to Lois the other night, I just can't seem to get to the point. Where is this point? You know, it's like I need to have some revelation here. And it felt like I couldn't get there, and maybe I've missed it. So I kept studying. Because when I can't see something, I don't give up. I'm like a dog with a bone. I keep going till I can get a breakthrough. And so I just kept reading it and studying and going on the internet and trying to get more information and commentaries about this particular passage. And you know, when I was thinking about it, you know, in the process, I was thinking, well, we're saved. And so if we're saved, our salvation is certain, so we don't need to be concerned about it. So what is this whole thing about the helmet of salvation? As I studied more, I discovered the missing point. I found it by reading a similar passage that Paul had spoken to the Thessalonian church. It's found in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 8, where he said, but let us who live in the light be clear headed, protected by the armor of faith and love, and wearing as our helmet the confidence, or as some versions say, the hope of our salvation. So the helmet is the confidence or the hope of our salvation. So the point is not so much being saved, but the confidence it gives and the hope it provides. And that's because salvation is being worked out. We don't have to work for it, but it's working for us every day. You don't just get saved and that's it. That's why when people just get saved and they just kind of go, that's it, I've got a place in heaven, I don't need to go to church, I don't need to develop or build my life, I don't need to be discipled, I don't need to move on, I've got a place in heaven. But here's the thing, salvation is not just about heaven, it's about earth. It's about life, not just death. Salvation is about helping us to see that there's something attached to salvation called power that can work out in our lives on a daily basis. So we are doing ourselves an injustice by not developing as believers every single day and allowing that salvation to work out, because it is so huge. It won't even be experienced in a lifetime. It goes beyond into eternity. But there's a lot that we can experience on earth from our salvation. We experience a little bit more each day. And that salvation, one of the main keys of what we're looking at right now, is the confidence it gives. The confidence to believe when we could doubt. The confidence to stay when we could leave. The confidence to step up when we could stand down, to stand out when we could blend in, to live in hope when we could be in despair. Amen? Often when a runner is on the home stretch of a race, he suddenly hits a wall. His legs wobble and refuse to go any further. The only hope for the runner is to keep his mind on the goal, on the finish line, and his thoughts on the victory. It's that hope that keeps him going when every other part of him wants to give up. That's why it says in Isaiah 40 verse 31, but those whose hope is in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. You can make it to the end of the race. You can keep going today. Whatever you're feeling, whatever your body is saying, you might feel like giving up, but keep going. Don't quit. Amen. That's what that helmet does. I hope that, you know, by bringing some helmets out that we recognize, it helps us to relate to what it's saying and how it protects and what it protects. Let me see if I can just open this up a little bit more. See, salvation is not just about the wrong it corrects, but the hope it provides. Being made right with God is only one element of salvation, but when we've been made right with God, there's a life to be lived. There's hope that comes from that salvation that we didn't have before we got saved. Before we gave our life to Jesus, we had no hope. We were doomed. We were doomed. Some of you know what I'm talking about there. Some of you know I'm showing my age. Some of you haven't got a clue. We're doomed. Well, we were doomed until we gave our lives to Jesus. And now, because we gave our lives to Jesus, there's hope. Doesn't matter look at how hopeless it looks. We've got hope, and we can be hopeful. It will keep our chin up when our luck's down. It will keep us going on when we could give up. It will keep us positive when we could be negative. It will keep us optimistic when we could be pessimistic. It will keep us strong when we could get weak. It will keep us alive when we could die. It will keep us focused when we could get frustrated. Come on. Someone get excited in this place. That's why I believe that there's so many passages on renewing our mind. This is one of the most important parts of the armor. Because if the devil can get to our mind, it doesn't really matter about the rest of it. It's gone. It's not going to protect us if this is unprotected. See, you know, the enemy can fire all sorts, but what he's trying to do is get into our head. So there's so many passages on renewing the mind, capturing our thoughts, controlling our imagination, because we need to keep our hopes up. Like this one, 2 Corinthians 10 verse 4, the weapons of the war we're fighting are not of this world, but are powered by God and effective at tearing down the strongholds erected against his truth. We are demolishing arguments and ideas, every high and mighty philosophy that pits itself against the knowledge of the one true God. We are taking prisoners of every thought, every emotion, and subduing them into obedience to the Anointed One. We got to protect the blows to the head, because the enemy is always inflicting blows on us, hitting us with disappointment, smacking us with despair, smashing us with doubt, whacking us with disappointment. But if we put that on, if we put that on, if we put that on, it will prevent all of the blows taking any effect. The enemy will hit, but it won't hurt. He can smack, but it won't sting. He can smash, but it won't shatter. He can whack, but it won't wound. Amen? And he's going to carry on whether you got that on or not. But it's okay. It's going to protect you. It's going to protect you. It's hardcore. I was praying then it didn't smash. It's hardcore. It's ready for a riot. Are you ready for a riot? See, you can be prepared for a riot. Don't think that just because you believe in Jesus, it's going to mean that the devil doesn't bother with you anymore. In fact, the very fact that you believe in Jesus means he's going to be bothering with you even more. That's why we got to wear this. Oh, but I don't like wearing hats. Join the club. But we need to wear this one. We need to wear our riot helmet. Hardcore. Put our riot shield up. Put our shoes on. Put our belt of truth on. Put our bulletproof vest on so that we go out into that riot and say, come on then, devil. You're going down. You can fight me with everything you got, but you're going down. Because I can fight this fight. I'm ready. I'm prepared. I can handle it. Amen. So the only way we can keep our hopes up is to put our helmet on. It keeps us hopeful when we could be hopeless. Because as believers, there's never any reason to lose hope. Listen to this. And you can quote this to people who, you know, when they say, well, I've lost all hope. I've lost all belief. You know, whatever their situation. Listen to this. Hebrews 6 and verse 18 says, we who have run for our very lives to God have every reason to grab the promised hope with both hands and never let go. In other words, you know, I love that because it's talking about grabbing hold of hope. So here we go. We grab hold of hope. This is our hope. Now that's no good, grabbing it with both hands, if you don't put it on. And I'm not putting it on. I've got far too much on my head today that I'm dealing with to put that on top. But anybody want to put it on? Anybody? Go on, Chris. Chris is going to be my model up here today. Come up on the platform and put it on. There we are. Tell Chris to put it on. Put it on. Look at that. Yeah, I'll hold your glasses. Fantastic. Now, Chris is ready for battle. He's ready for the enemy to whack him and smash him and do whatever else he wants to do to him. Look at that. You aren't going to get through there. That's hardcore armor right there. Fantastic. Thanks, Chris. Awesome. Anybody want to try it after? You're welcome. Hardcore helmet. Look at that. So we've got to make sure that we put it on and grab hold of that hope and put it on. Now you know why Paul was so positive writing the things that he put in the Bible. He said this in 2 Timothy 1 verse 11. For this gospel, I was appointed a preacher, an apostle, and teacher. And because of this, in fact, I suffer as I do. Did you read that? Because of this, I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed because I know the one in whom I believe or my faith is set, and I am convinced that he is able to protect what has been entrusted me until that day. He knew, and because he knew, he was set. And because he was set, he was convinced. And because he was convinced, God was able. We have to enable God. We have to do the things that he has asked us to do in order for him to do what he needs to do. And so if he says, put the helmet of salvation on, put your confidence on, put your hope in me, then we've got to wear it. We can't just look at it. We can't just quote it. We can't just talk about it. We got to wear it. We got to do what he's asked us to do to be fully protected for the battle ahead. Amen? In other words, Paul, because he kept his helmet on, was able to work through the things that he had to go through, and God was able to work in his life in such a way that things would pan out. So in other words, God was enabled because Paul made it possible for God to be able. So let's ensure our heads protected, our minds secure. I'm kicking it and moving it and it's not going down. Because having confidence keeps our hope alive. If there's one thing under attack, it's the confidence we have in God. It's a hope that we have for the future. See, hope doesn't just change our present. It changes our future. It affects everything about the future. So when the enemy tries to attack your mind, not just with questions of unworthiness, that's one angle. He'll come in pretty much every week and try that one. You might not give in to it. You might not even feel it sometimes, because maybe he hasn't found a chink yet to get in on the unworthiness. But what he'll do is not give up on that. So he'll go, okay, I'll come back another day. I'll come back on a day when they've made a massive mistake in their life and they're going to feel so unworthy that that's the chink I can get in. Because I know that they're going to feel bad about what they've said or what they've done or what they thought. So I'm going to get in on that day. But there's other days when you haven't necessarily made a big mistake that you're aware of. But what he'll do is try and come in and rob some other thought from you and mess with your mind and mess with another aspect of your salvation, which is about your future. So maybe you're let down in some way at the workplace. You were promised something and it's not come to fruition. So what the enemy's going to do is come in and steal that thought of God saying, listen, I planned your future. For I know your future. I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you and give you a future. So what he's going to do, because you're convinced of that, he's going to come in on that day when your future isn't looking too good. Maybe you've received some news. Maybe you've had something happen in your life. Maybe you got a report from the doctor and it wasn't what you expected. And now your future is in question. What are you going to do? You need to put your helmet on. You need to say, do you know what? I know who holds my future. I might not know what my future holds, but I know who holds my future. And I'm going to keep my salvation helmet on today because I know this not only affects my present, but my future. So come on, let's stand today as I finish. Let's grab hope today and put our head in it. Let's grab hope today and put our head in it. There's every reason to. I'll tell you why. I hope this encourages you today. We're winners, not losers. We're victors, not victims. We're successes, not failures. We're ahead, not behind. We're above, not beneath. We're in it to win it. Amen? Because God has fixed the fight. And I saw the result. We win, the devil loses. We got the winning numbers. Listen, 3-16. Think about it. Think about it. Let it drop. Let it drop. Let it drop. You got it? Anybody got it? Put your hand up if you got it. 3-16. John, 3-16. We got the winning numbers. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that we might not perish but have eternal life. We got salvation because we've got the winning numbers. We hit the jackpot. Woo! And I saw the score. 1-0. 1-0. The enemy can never score. There's no other result because there's no other outcome. And if that doesn't get you clapping your hands and giving God a big shout of praise today, I don't know what will. We are winners. Yeah. Come on, if we were at a football match right now and our winning team was winning, we'd be going, yeah. Come on. Oh, we're losing our inhibitions in church. Isn't that good? We're winners. We cannot lose. Doesn't matter what you think about it, what it does, but I mean, it doesn't change it. All that it does is mean that you're going to struggle when you don't need to struggle. Why would you want to struggle? Because here's the thing. Every principality and power can come at you all at the same time, and it still doesn't have to get you down. It still doesn't have to pull you down. It still doesn't have to overcome you because you can overcome it. So those days when you wake up and you're not feeling yourself, it's probably nothing that you've done. It's the principalities and powers working on you to try and bring you down. And what you've got to do is get up, put that helmet on before you leave the house and go, right, I'm in a riot today. I can feel it already because I'm already feeling the discouragement coming my way. I know what that's like. I often do that on a Sunday and I have to put my helmet on straight away. If I didn't do it, I wouldn't even make it to church, let alone preach a message. What would you think of me, if Lois came along one Sunday and said, sorry, pastor's in bed depressed today. He's not coming. Because the enemy discouraged him this morning. He's not coming. I have to put my helmet on. Don't think because I'm up here that it's any easier than being where you are. We're all in this together. I'm being aimed at all the time, because if this encourages you today, if my passion from this message affects you in some way today, and you go out and you live differently this week, do you think the enemy's going to be happy with that? I tell you what, I need to wear this in the next 7 days more than I've ever worn it before. I need to go to bed in it. I need to make sure that the enemy can't even get to my head when I'm asleep, which isn't very often nowadays. The enemy's trying all sorts of stuff. But if we wear this, there's no way he's going to get through anymore and twist the truth and twist all the thoughts in our mind that we've already got settled. So we are winners. Who wants to pray today? Who wants to end this just with some kind of declaration prayer that we just bring before God and say, God, I've heard your word today, and I want to just make some statements so that I go into this week fully empowered, fully energized, on fire for you, knowing that whatever the enemy throws at us, I'm going to make it. So just say these words with me. Lord, today I've been reminded of how the enemy is trying to mess with my head so I'll lose my mind. But I'm going to grab hope firmly with both hands and put my head in it, because it only takes one thought today to change my life forever. One positive thought will lift me up and move me on. Thank you for my salvation, which enables me to see the positive in every negative and to see the possible in every impossible, the solution in every problem. I am a winner, not a loser, a victor, not a victim, a success, not a failure. The enemy can inflict the blows, but it's okay, because my helmet's going to protect my head and guard my mind. And because of you, Jesus, I've hit the jackpot. Amen. In Jesus' name.
Amen. We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.